when people say liver failure, it actually encompasses two different diseases. One would be an acute liver failure, and this happens in patients without any underlying liver disease. For acute liver failure, symptoms can vary, but patients can present with nausea, vomiting, extreme fatigue, or changes in their mental status, or feeling foggy in their head. Some people may present with jaundice, and oftentimes with abdominal pain. And the second group would be the chronic liver failure. And this would be in patients who actually have chronic liver disease or end-stage liver disease like cirrhosis. And this would be more common than the acute liver failure. For patients with chronic liver failure, the symptoms would include jaundice, again, the yellowing of the eyes and skin, fluids building up in their stomach, or having changes in their mental status, like we mentioned earlier, and sometimes even bleeding from the stomach. So the common causes of acute liver failure include acetaminophen toxicity or Tylenol overdose, and that's followed by any other drug-induced liver injury. So these are the most common causes of acute liver failure in the US. When you look at the world, the top causes also include viral hepatitis, and most commonly hepatitis A, B, and E. For chronic liver disease and end-stage liver disease, it is more commonly in patients with viral hepatitis, such as hepatitis B or C. Alcohol-induced liver injury would be another common risk factor to have end-stage liver disease. Some other causes also that are rising and becoming very common would be non-alcoholic fatty liver disease that's running in parallel with the obesity in the U.S. There are less common causes, including some genetic diseases such as copper or iron overload or autoimmune liver disease that can also contribute to end-stage liver disease or cirrhosis. For chronic liver failure, the only curative treatment that is available is liver transplantation. So that's why we focus a lot on trying to pick up the disease early on and to treat the disease before it becomes end-stage liver disease. For instance, for hepatitis C, now that we have a curative treatment for hepatitis C, we try to screen everyone who were born from 1945 to 1965 so they can actually be eligible to get hep C treated. Same thing with non-alcoholic fatty liver disease or alcohol-induced liver disease. We try to detect this early so we can have lifestyle preventions and try to prevent the disease from progression. For acute liver failure, there are different drugs that people are testing to see if we can improve the management of these patients who are critically ill. For chronic liver disease, there's a lot of focus in terms of understanding the mechanism of fibrosis, which is the scarring of the liver that ends up with cirrhosis. And to understand that process, and once we know that process more, I think there'll be drugs that'll be available for treatment. Also, with the rising incidence of non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, there's a lot of research focused on developing drugs to effectively treat non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Once a patient has acute or chronic liver failure, the management really involves multiple disciplinary team members. For instance, someone who is in the ICU with acute liver failure, the patient will be co-managed by the intensivist as well as the hepatologist, and also involve the transplant surgeon as well to see the course of this illness and how the patient is doing. For chronic liver disease or cirrhosis, as liver transplantation is one of the main treatment options, there is a whole team of liver transplantation team members who would be managing the patients. This not only includes just the medical hepatologist and transplant surgeons, but also includes anesthesia, social work, psychiatry, and all of them are involved in the care of the patients. One of the fatal complications of cirrhosis is also liver cancer. And even with liver cancer, it is a multidisciplinary management where there is the hepatologist, hepatobiliary or transplant surgeon involved, as well as radiologists. That includes interventional radiologists, medical oncologists, and radiation oncologists as well. So that's why in Hopkins we have a multidisciplinary liver cancer clinic where all the team members can discuss each case together to figure out the best treatment plan for that patient. And this is the same with our liver transplant evaluation clinic, where a patient will see different specialty team members in their visit when they come to our clinic.